get started, y'all. My name is Jeremy Abbott, and today we're going to talk about writing a web app using functional programming in F#. So thank you guys for being here after lunch. It's okay to take a nap right now. I kind of want to also. Before we get started, who here has some experience with functional programming? All right, so y'all are allowed to interrupt me and say you're wrong, or politely though, because I don't want to give wrong information. But for the rest of y'all, I'm super interruptible. Raise your hand. We can talk about some of the stuff I'm going to demonstrate today if it's kind of weird. And that's kind of important, so I don't want anybody to get lost. And if you want to wait till after, we can talk about it too, or I can show you some code. A part of this talk is like a high-level overview of a couple of concepts that we're going to go over for the application itself, but it's not everything. So also, can y'all in the back hear me okay? Can you guys see the slides okay? Okay, cool. All right, so like I said, we're talking about writing a web app using functional programming in F#. F# is a programming language on the .NET stack. You can use anything in .NET you can basically do in F#. And like I said, I'm Jeremy. You can find me on Twitter at Mr. J. Abbott, and I have a little blog that I don't update ever. So it's the best of, I had the best of intentions, but it's like my stack of shame of books at home that I buy and I'm supposed to read like one a month and I never do. Same thing. If you look for Jeremy Abbott on Twitter, this is who you're going to find. He's a figure skater, and I bring that up because even people like my aunt will call me during the Winter Olympics, like, I didn't realize that you went into figure skating. And we look nothing alike, but yeah, so it's not me if you see that one. I don't have a blue check mark. That's how you know. I work for a company called Praesis in Shreveport, Louisiana, and I'm the developer manager and the software architect for that, our development team. We are hiring right now, and it's actually a really great place to work. They let us do things like going to conferences, which is probably a big sell for y'all since you're here from work also for the most part. But they also do some pretty cool stuff to try to enhance our development culture and to stay interested and hungry for learning. One of the things we do is called a science fair, and we do that twice a year. And the way that pans out is we get 3 days to work on technologies that interest us that we don't get to do in our day-to-day jobs because, you know, you gotta ship stuff and you gotta make customers happy. But we set aside that time to check out the things that interest us and play around. And then on like that Friday, we will do demos. Like every team that does something will do a demo, and then we vote on it. And somebody, like the winners, get a blue ribbon and a trophy. And then we go like to a brewery afterwards and have fun. So that's one of my favorite things to do. We're really we're cool with remote work. We have people who actually live in Arkansas, Guam, Oklahoma, Chicago, and we're cool with that. So hit me up after the talk, or you can go out to our table out there. And I think that's all of the housekeeping stuff. I was lying. We have slides. Slides are on Azure and they're on GitHub. If you want to get them off Azure, there's slides to other talks also. So you can go to tinyurl.com/suavefp. On GitHub, it's jeremyabbott/presentations. And these slides were created using an F# tool called FS Reveal, which is basically just a wrapper around JS Reveal. So this is all Markdown, but one of the cool things about this tool is it does really great code formatting with tooltips. So like I can mouse over a function and it's gonna show you like what the inputs are and what the outputs are. And you're gonna see some of that today too. And the code's gonna be at tinyurl.com/F#codesamples, and there's samples for more than just this talk. Cool. So why functional programming in general? First and foremost, for me, it's fun. I like learning new stuff. It's changed the way I do OOP and imperative style programming. One of the big hallmarks of functional programming is this idea of default immutability, or at least depending on the language. Like you can do functional programming in JavaScript, but you can still mutate state. But in like a true functional programming language or a language where that's a bigger, their emphasis is bigger, your default state is immutable. So you can't like instantiate something and then change a value on it. You can like map it and create a copy of it with different properties or whatever, but you can't just immediately change something. And that's kind of helpful in, you know, when you're programming in general, it helps with correctness to be able to tell immediately where in a function something actually did change because you know that function is what did it, instead of this idea of immutability in global state where this could have happened anywhere in your stack trace and you just have to hope you find it. It's also great, immutability is important for things like distributed programming or when you're dealing with like concurrency. You don't have to worry about like locking your object if you're gonna have a bunch of different working in a cluster or working in parallel. And what else do I got for that? F# in particular, not every functional language is statically typed, but F# is. It also has really strong type inference. So when we see the code samples, one of the things you're going to notice is I almost never am explicitly declaring my types, but the compiler knows what's going on. And that helps you write code a little faster. And it's some of the syntax is not, the syntax isn't as distracting, so it makes it easier to read. And you're going to see some of that too. So let's talk, like I said, I promised a brief Cliff Notes version of some of the higher level functional programming things that you're going to see in the demos. And we're going to start with the idea of higher order functions. Who was in Timmy's talk this morning? All right, so some of y'all. So I could skip it, but I'm not going to. Higher order functions are just functions that either accept a function as an input or they return a function after it's executed. And there's a few ways to do that in F#. So the main emphasis behind higher order functions is this idea of, you know, creating general purpose functions that we can use across business domains. And then within those business domains or science domain or whatever domain you're in, I can then create those specific functions just by composing these general purpose ones. Cool. So the first idea we're going to talk about is partial application. And this is something that's out of the box in F#. There are libraries that can help you do it in other languages like JavaScript, but I feel like in those scenarios, it's actually muddies the waters more than helps you. So that's just my opinion, though. But the idea behind partial application is this. A function can have multiple arguments to it, and that's technically not true, but we'll pretend it is for this conversation. And I'll tell you why in a second. But when you partially apply a function, you only pass it some of its parameters. So like, for example, if I have a function that takes two parameters and I only pass it one, what would you expect to get back? Well, in most languages, you'd expect a compiler warning at a minimum. In F#, you get back a new function that accepts one parameter and returns a value. And so that's what partial application is. And so if you want to put that into the vein of higher order functions, what you can say with that is I have a function that I want to make more specific and get another function out. So an arbitrary example here is this idea of add. Add takes an integer or two integers and returns an integer. Well, I can partially apply that function by just passing it 5, and I get back a function that accepts an integer and returns an integer. And in this case, that it's going to add 5 to whatever I pass it. So that's the general idea behind partial application. This is not the best example of it, but I wanted to keep it kind of clear that a really common use case is, or just I wanted to abstract out that idea of multiple parameters, only pass in one of them, and get a function back. This is a more realistic example using like tools that I use pretty often in F# in general. And the idea here is I want to like map over an array of something. And so array.map as a part of just the F# language accepts a function to map over and an array. And that's the order they go in. Well, let's say I want a more specific version of array.map that calls add5 on the array you pass it. So I can create that function here. And like I said, if I mouse over array.map, the syntax is kind of weird, but you can see that the t goes to u is a function that takes in a t and converts it into a u. That was the first parameter. Second parameter being an array of t, whatever that is. So what I get out of this when I pass it add5 is a new function that accepts an integer and returns an integer. So it's that same idea of partial application. I have a more specific function now that will do this thing, and I can use it in other places. And then I can, when I go use it, I can just pass it an array, and I get back my values. And again, if you guys have any questions, please stop. You're going to see some more examples of this, though. The last thing we're going to talk about at the high level is this idea of function composition. So I can have a bunch of general purpose functions or maybe more specific ones that I've created through higher order functions. And I can compose them to create even more functions. So in this case, composition is talking about just combining two functions together to create a new one. And so I have, again, a function called add5, and it just adds 5 to a number. And I have another function called multiply by 4, and it adds or multiplies the number by 4. So this is a really important business problem that I'm going to use all the time, obviously. So I'm going to compose it. And so all I do is I use this composition operator here. And that's the double greater than sign, basically. And On the left-hand side, I have the first function, and on the right-hand side is the second function that I'm going to compose together. And that gives me a new function that's going to first add 4 to the input, or add 5 to the input, and then take the result of that and multiply it by 5. And I wrote it down as a second way to sort of show what function composition is actually doing. So what's really happening here is I have a function that accepts an input, and I call, this is what's on the left, my add 5. I'm going to evaluate that first, and then I'm going to pass the result of that to the second function. So that's one of the weird things about F-sharp is the order of operations is more mathematical than like what you would see in a normal programming language. So like where you put the parentheses actually it matters just like it does in any language, but it's a different context. Like if I didn't put the parentheses here, it would try to pass this function to multiply by 4, which it doesn't take, and things get weird. So that's function composition. And again, I want to give you like a more pragmatic example of what's going to happen instead of these weird math things that we would never actually do because nobody needs that. And so again, I have another function off of the array module, and it's array.filter. So it basically accepts a predicate in an array. So I passed it in a lambda, a predicate that will return true if the number is divisible by 2. And I can create a function off of that that basically just accepts an integer and will return me a new integer, or accepts an array and will return me a new array that only has even numbers in it. And so then I can compose that evens function with array.sum, which also accepts an array of integers and returns an array of integers, really any array, but in this case it's an integer. And then after I compose those, I have a new function that accepts an integer, returns an, or accepts an array and returns an array, and I can pipe it. So same sort of idea. The most common piece here being this idea of using one of our general purpose functions like array.filter and then making it more specific for a use case that we care about. And if you're familiar with like C# and Lync, we probably have all had like that where statement that we use all the time, and it would be nice if that was more specific that we could just grab instead of rewriting the same thing over and over again. And that's basically what the idea here is. Cool, so anybody have any questions? I could, yeah, this could just be evens and it would accept a integer and return a Boolean. Cool, so that's the high level stuff about it. And now we're going to talk about the framework that we're going to use today. The framework is called Suave, and it's a web server and application framework that's written specifically for F#. And that's important because it uses things like custom operators, which is something you can create in F#, and you can't do that in C#. I mean, you can overload stuff and do some weird things, but I wouldn't do that. But in F#, it's actually a big deal. You've seen a few of them, like the function composition, the pipe operator, and a few other things. So this is specifically for F#. Why would you use this over like web API? We're talking about the .NET stack, obviously, but I would use this over like ASP.NET or web API, and I'm hoping to show that through examples. I like writing web APIs this way. I think that it's fairly semantic and removes a lot of ceremony. Towards the end of this, we're going to see the starting point for like a CRUD RESTful style web API, and you'll see that it doesn't take a lot of code, but it's pretty clean and gives you all the functionality that you would get out of something like web API. Let's see. Whoa, that's fun. So let me see if I missed anything there. Good. All right, so the first thing you need to know about Suave is that because it's a functional framework, it's not surprising that it's kind of modeled around the idea of a web server being a function, which is really a cool idea if you think about it. So it's a function that really accepts some HTTP thing. In this case, it's an HTTP context. And it returns some HTTP thing. In this case, it's another HTTP context. That's wrapped in an async, and it may or may not actually be there. And that's kind of a weird idea, but we'll get into why that is. But just so you know, an HTTP context is basically a request object and a response object. So again, if you're from .NET, and this again applies to like Node too, because like all your callbacks have a request and a response and error or something like that. It's the same idea. We're going to need both of those pieces of information to handle our HTTP request. And the idea in Suave is to use these web parts and compose them to create our different endpoints that we're going to respond to. Right. So before we show you some examples of how that works, I want to talk about the idea of a filter and a web part and sort of like separate components, and we'll show how to compose those together. So like I said, a web part is basically a function, but in F#, functions can also be types. So I can just, whenever I see a function signature that accepts a web part, it's actually accepting another function. So it goes back to that idea of higher order functions being something that can accept a function. And so, this is an example here of actual partial application. So if I'm on path, which you're not going to know because I don't have everything loaded to see this, but path accepts a string and returns a web part. So at this point, I can pass it hello, and it's going to return a web part, which is a function. So I have a function now that basically only is going to respond to a request that has /hello as the route. So if you think back to like any sort of MVC framework that you've used where you have a route table, this is how you would define a really basic route. And then another web part this is a function, but in this case, I don't need to pass it anything to get just the web part piece out, is get. And what this does is it filters on requests that have the HTTP method of get. And like in a web API or something like that, you would maybe decorate that with an attribute like http.get or whatever the case may be. So in Suave, we have this idea of programming with the fish operator. And the fish operator is this little guy right here. And it's greater than, equal, greater than. And the fish operator is a type of combinator. Combinators can take multiple things of the same type and return a single instance of that type based on what it was passed in. So it's like transformations. In this case, so web parts are functions, so we're really chaining together functions to do some work. The key thing about web parts is that they short circuit. So like I can create this long chain, but if any point in there we don't match anymore, like what the request is, we'll drop out of it, which is really helpful. We don't need to keep going if there's no more work to do. So putting all of this together is this idea of a whole request pipeline. So I want to have a route that says when I send back /hello and it's a get request, I want to write a response to the body of hello, and it's going to be a 200, or so an okay response. That's pretty semantic to read right here, right? This is an actual full web request. So I have a web part for hello, a web part saying get, and then I can write a response. So if we break that down again for a second, what's going to happen here is if I hit any other request path that isn't /hello, I stop at this point. If it is hello, but I did a post for some reason, I would stop at this point. And if I get through those two, then there is no actual filtering happening here. I'm just going to write a 200 and hello to the body. So that's the high-level idea of composing these things. I already explained all that. Cool, we're good. So we're about to look at some code, but does anybody have any questions before we really dive into it? Am I talking too fast? All right. Y'all in the back, can you see this okay? How about now? All right. I'm going to zoom back out for a second. So this is a basic F# console application. If you do file new project console and choose F# for your language, this is roughly what you'll get minus this bit right here. You're just going to say print the args to the console by default. There's also two NuGet packages that I've added here. There's one for Suave and one for Newtonsoft.json. And you don't have to use Newtonsoft, but the default JSON serializer uses is like the .NET data contract serializer, and that's not as much fun to work with. So just include Newtonsoft, and hopefully in the next version they'll make it a dependency instead and use that. So how do I set this up? The function that we're interested in really is you start it with a function called start web server. And again, this comes back to one of the reasons I like functional programming is this is pretty semantic to read. And the function's doing what it says it does. So start web server, and I pass it a config. All I'm doing with this config is changing the default the default port it uses when you start it up locally. So I'm using 8084. And the main reason I did that is because my slides were running locally earlier on 8083, which is the default. And it's actually doing that because the slides run locally using Suave. So I needed to run them both, and that's how I did it. And so basically, that takes start web server takes two parameters, one being the configuration, and the other being a web part. And that's going to be really interesting to think about for a second. And we're going to see how that works. And before I show it to you, I want you to remember when I said you can compose functions together to create a new function. So when you start to see some of this, I want you to keep that in mind. So simple.simpleapp is a function that returns a web part that I wrote. And if I go look at it, there's a few things that are happening here. There's another filtering web part called choose. Choose accepts a list of web parts, and it will execute each of those, because a web part is a function, until one of them returns a matching request, or whatever the case may be, until it returns some. In this case, so if I do slash hello, it's going to, and it matches, it might do that. If it fails, it's going to go all the way down and keep going until it finds one that matches. And if it doesn't, you get an actual error. So, but what's interesting here is, like I said, choose is returning a single web part. So through this idea of filters and composition, all of these little small web parts that I created for specific use cases are being composed back together into the entire application. And that's really important to keep in mind. Yes, sir. It might be a linked list under the hood, but the actual data type in F-sharp is a specific F-sharp data type called a list, and it's one that you traverse recursively. It's got a head and a tail, but because of immutability, it's really hard to implement a linked list with immutable state, so that's where the recursive traversal comes in.
Okay.
It's basically like an array, but not quite. But thank you for the question. Did everybody hear that, by the way? Okay. Oh, thank you. The question was, how is this list data type that we're using for choose implemented under the hood? And I don't know for sure, but I know that the way you use it is recursively. Cool. So we know that choose accepts a list of web parts, and it in itself is returning a web part as a result of that. So let's look at the individual ones and talk about some of the important things that happen here. So if I mouse over hello part, again, that's its own web part. And I can go and say, you already saw this example basically, so I don't need to go over it too much, but the main gist is, this is a web path accepts a string and returns a web part. I'm composing that with okay, which accepts a string and returns a web part. And this is the most basic route I have here, and it's like slash hello. A more interesting example is this idea of path scan. And what this is doing is it takes a format string and creates a strongly typed route. So this is a route that accepts an integer. That that input, though, is strongly typed if I use it later. And so I've actually created this entire web part in two parts. First, I created the path scan part to define the route. Path scan also needs a function to use to handle that route, so that input value. And so I did that on the second line. Again, that's partial application. I didn't pass it all the stuff it needed. And part of that I did it for clarity, because I didn't want to go like all the way to the right, because horizontal scrolling is terrible. And so over here with a, that's not helpful. So with hello with ID path, I'm just passing it a lambda that which accepts an integer and does something with it. In this case, it's just formatting a response with that ID, and again, writing it to the body with a 200. But that's how you would create your, like, you can think of this as, if I wanted to get something by ID, this is how I would do that. And then one thing that's really important about this is, when the application starts up, when I called start web server, it actually runs everything once, and that's the only time it runs it. And then all of it through basically, I don't want to say closures because it's not quite, but basically through how everything gets executed at once, it doesn't run again. So that can be problematic, and we're going to look at why. So before I run this, I want to point out, random just calls next, which is a function I defined up here. Next basically calls this random number generator and converts it to a string. Not anything super exciting happening. So I'm using a tool called Postman to run this, and I'm going to run it, and I'll zoom in for you. So my route is /random on port 8084, and it returned 4. So I'm going to run it again. I got 4 back. And maybe it's a coincidence, but if I keep running it, it's 4 forever. And if we look at our code again for a second, what's basically happening here is this whole thing, like I said, is executed when the app starts up, and that's the only time it's ever executed. So if I need to, that's not incredibly ideal, because if you imagine a use case where I need to get back a list of something from the database, I don't want that to be cached forever. And you can do that pretty easily. Like, hey, I'm going to go create all these objects, and my get all doesn't work. And I've done this from experience, which is why I know this happens. And that's because I didn't read the documentation. So I'm saving you guys some pain, first of all. You need to wrap these kinds of functions that are actually going to return a list that you can't control what the value is going to be in a closure. And you do that through this thing called a warbler. And it's a really weird name. It comes from some like category theory and some math stuff that I really cannot speak to. I don't have a doctoral in mathematics or computer science yet, maybe someday. But the idea here is I'm just wrapping this in a closure, and this closure will get called on every request. Because basically what it's saying, under the hood, it's what it's saying is, I don't know what to do. There's some input that I'm expecting before I can finish calculating that. And now that we've gotten to this point, I can point out that that's actually what PassScan is doing too, for the same reason. If I'm expecting a parameter back, I'm probably gonna have to do something depending on what that is. And so it's a decision that's made on the request instead of beforehand. So the big takeaway here is if I go call random fixed, which I realize is a really bad name, because random fixed could imply that it's a fixed value that comes back. But in this context, it means I fixed it so that it actually returns a random number. Naming is hard, y'all. And of course, it returned 4 twice in a row, and I started to panic. But it actually is random, so hooray. So that's a really basic example, and let's go create an actual REST API we care about now that can do like create stuff, return a list of it, and then we'll see how much time we have left. So I'm going to go back to my app start, and we're going to start a different web server that does something a little more interesting. Let's uncomment that out. And we're going to create a concert app that shows a list of concerts, and then we can add venues, or not venues, but actual shows to it. And it's really basic, but I like going to live music. I went to 2 shows last weekend. That's what I try to do in my free time, such as it is. And so let's run this one, and I'll show you how it works. I've got 2 endpoints right now, one for just getting a list of concerts back, and one for creating new concerts. And if I look at the body, I'll zoom in for you. It's just a JSON string with a band, a venue, and a date. And this is the concert I went to last weekend, one of them. And so if I go and hit send, I'll get back the response, 200. And it's technically not right, but this is an example. It should be a 201 or something for created. But the main idea here being I got something back with an ID. So we're in good shape. Let's go look at how we did all that, though. And this is where I hope you'll start to see the real productive value of doing it this way, because when I show it to you, this is literally all the code I had to write for the web application side of this. And I'm doing the get and the add. If I were to do this like in web API, it would probably be at least twice as long. There'd be a lot more configuration to set up. There'd be several more files. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with using that if there's a use case for it. And there definitely is. Maybe they don't want to learn F#, or y'all don't want to learn F#. And that's totally valid. But I really like working in this way. And it presents some opportunities for more distributed programming. More reactive programming, so if I want to like do some event sourcing or create a WebSocket that responds to certain requests in certain ways, that's going to be easier to do in functional programming, and I already have a built-in web framework to do that. So again, though, if we just look at the basics here, I'm creating a few resources. We're going to talk about it because this is where higher-ordered functions get really interesting. So I did some boilerplate stuff that's based around the idea of REST APIs generally have some common use cases depending on, or for any resource. I probably want to create some and delete some and get some. So I started creating some models that represent what that looks like. If I'm a get list resource, I am a function that may not accept any parameters. In this case, we're assuming it doesn't. We actually want everything. If this was a huge database, we might want to include some paging and maybe a page number parameter. In this case, we're assuming it's a small data set. And it returns a sequence, which is an F-sharp equivalent to an IEnumerable of A, or type A. Then I have another type, which again, this is a function, and it is basically accepting a type A and returning a type A. And in a real web API, I would probably have different types for my input and output, and another middle type that matches the domain object I'm actually working with, but again, just an example. And then I have, so these are what are called, in this case, it's a record type, and that's an F-sharp specific thing that it creates a mutable, it's almost like an object, but once you create it, you can't do anything else, you can't mutate it. You can copy it, and you're gonna see how to do that, and I did it one with my config earlier, but you cannot like change properties on it. And then something else here called a discriminated union, which is my API resource. A discriminated union is like an enumeration, except it's on steroids. So in an enumeration, like if you're in pretty much every other language, you have a bunch of labels, and then you either assign like a byte to it, or you're gonna assign a integer to it. And it's usually zero based, unless you're like in VB, and I think it's one based because VB. I don't know how that works. And so this is basically like an enumeration, and it is an abstraction over the idea of the different API resources I defined above. So an API resource could be a list resource, it could be a get resource, or I'm sorry, an add resource, and I could create other ones here, but for the sake of this conversation, we'll just look at those two. And then I created a helper function that will, based on the type of resource, generate the web part for me, which is pretty cool. Then remember, a web part's a function, but if we think of it just as a type, some of that weirdness goes away and we can feel good about, oh, we're just returning an object almost, or something. So this function accepts two things, and this is the first time you guys have probably seen in my code a explicit type definition, or a data annotation, if you will. And so in this case, what's actually happening as two parameters, one for the name and then one for the resource type. In this case, the resource is an API resource, which means it could be actually a list or an add from those functions I defined above, or the signatures for those functions I defined above. And the first thing I do is I define a path, and this is kind of convention-based, right? It's gonna be slash whatever that resource name is, what I got from here. And resource path, and we've seen this before, it's just a web part. And then I do something really cool. I take resource path in my fish operator which will tell you I'm combining with another web part. So that's where the next part gets interesting. This little section right here is called pattern matching. And pattern matching is in the same way that enumerations are like, or I'm sorry, the same way discriminated unions are like enumerations on steroids, pattern matching is like a switch statement on steroids where, a pattern matching statement actually returns a value, and with like a switch statement, though you're generally not, unless you have like some sort of variable you set outside of it and you're setting it inside of there, but then it's not really a return at that point still. So pattern matching is really cool. You can match on the shape of things. Instead of saying it has to be equal to this or match this case statement, I'm matching on shape. So what I did here is, again, my resource is of API resource, and at this point I'm effectively matching on type, right? So if the API resource I pass in is of the add type or the list type, then we're gonna say we wanna use the get web part, because generally if I'm getting a list back, I'm not creating a resource, I'm not patching a resource, I'm not deleting it hopefully, take my whole site down. And then I'm going to use this warbler that we talked about earlier to get that list back. And this function this whole pattern assumes that I have some sort of function that matches that definition, and you're gonna see how that works in a second. There has to be something somewhere that actually implements this thing to get back my list of A, whatever that is. And then I pipe that to JSON, which is a function I created that basically serializes this object, and then pipes that to OK, because if you serialize it, it's a JSON string now, and then OK just takes a string. Same thing for add, it's a little bit different, but if I have the add type, I'm gonna use a post because I'm creating a resource, and then I can pipe that to request, which is basically like a warbler, but I'm only dealing with the request side of it, where the Warbler deals with the full context. So I had the response and the request. And I'm doing kind of the reverse. I get some JSON, I need to deserialize it, I need to add it, and then I need to serialize the result of that, whether it was successful or not. And that's what's happening here. So in both of these cases, R is a function. It's the function that behaves in the way that this signature defines. So R in this case is unit, doesn't take a parameter, but it returns a list. And in this case, in the case of add, R is a function that is going to accept a type of A and return a type of A. Cool, so I know that that's super intense. So let's actually use it, maybe it'll clear things up a little bit. So first things first, I want to get a list of concerts back. And concert list resource is a web part, because everything is. I call my build resource function, and I pass it a string. That's pretty basic. We could do this in any language. And then things get interesting. Here, I create a list union case from the API resources discriminated union, and I pass it a function. This function is called data.getConcerts. And I kind of cheated and, getConcerts is just going to return something back from a dictionary because I didn't want to set up a database for this. But it's the same idea. So if I go back now, so y'all know just by looking at this, this is a function that doesn't have any input or any inputs. Technically not true, but for the sake of this talk, it is. And returns a sequence of concerts. And concerts defined up here as another record type. This is the first one you've probably seen that isn't a function. This is an actual kind of object, if you will, that has different labels and data types on them. And so we have a function for, again, getting the concerts back. And we have a function for adding concerts. And add concert signature is accepts a concert and returns a concert. And again, I want to point out that most of these don't have signatures or data or type annotations. The compiler is smart and can figure it out. And I don't have to look at it and wonder about what it is because my naming is pretty good. So I can sort of, except for random fix a few minutes ago, I can figure out what's going on. So super readable. So I have two functions. Those two functions, again, match the signature that I defined for those types of resources. So I can create an instance of those resources, pass that function in, which is what it expects, and call and pass that to build resource. And it does the matching, creates the web part that will call that function I passed in. So I wish I had something to draw a line with, but the main idea here is this get concerts here is getting called here. This add concert here is getting called here. That makes sense, y'all? Awesome. So then I can create, this is very similar to what I did in the simple app where I used the choose filter with a couple of web parts. But basically I can say all my concert resources are going to be within this web part that is defined by choose and that array defined here, or list, I'm sorry. And again, what's really, one of the cool things about F-sharp is I know this is a list just by looking at it, but there aren't any type annotations. I don't have to say like new list or any weird syntax. It's just brackets, throw some data in there, and I rock and roll. And then just like we did with simple app earlier, I created a function that sort of wrapped everything up nice and neat. And it also has a choose, and it has a web part being concert resources, and another one being not found. And this handles the case where I try to hit anything other than the ones defined above here. And so like we can reason about this a little bit and say, well, I only have two routes. I have a get concert route and a post concert route. But if I try to do anything else, I'll get this nice not found response back. So let's run this one. And let's do this again. So if I say send, I'll get that back. And if I do get now, I get back a list with one concert in it. Say what? In Biggin? Absolutely. Somebody pick another band. Thank you. Somebody said Red Hot Chili Peppers, which I also like. That was the first concert I went to when I was 17. Red Hot Chili Peppers. And I'm picking the same date and venue. That would be a small venue for them, but that's okay. So now if I say get I should have two in there. So that's it, and it's returning as JSON. I'm a little biased since this is the point of my talk, but I really do think that this is a pretty nice semantic way of writing a web application. There's not a lot of heavy lifting. The only real work I had to do was around creating these types and this higher order function for creating like different web parts. But is that really any different from setting up structure map and auto mapper and creating these interfaces that in their default implementation and all of that other ceremony? I would say maybe not. And I did it with a lot less work. So I think that is it for the demo. Does anybody have any questions? I'm sorry, what is what? Oh, that's a great. So Warbler is a function that accepts a lambda. The lambda that it accepts is of the type HTTP context. And it's actually of type T to U, but you're generally returning a web part. So I don't really care what the HTTP context is or anything about that. But I have to say that I know there's an input there that I'm not going to use. Like I couldn't not, just like any other lambda, it has to match the signature that's expected. This is just an idiomatic way of saying, I don't care what the input is. I could make this X, and then if I mouse over it, it tells you that I can zoom in too. It'll tell you that the type is HTTP context, but it's also never going to be used. And if you actually look at it, you see it's like a light gray instead of white. Maybe not, but trust me, it is, because I'm not using it. So this is, besides the compiler telling you, or Visual Studio being helpful, just by saying this, it's a clear way to somebody else looking at your code. I don't care what the value of the input is. I'm not going to use it. I just needed a lambda here. So any other questions? So I love that you asked that question, and also kind of sad because I don't like talking about monads most because I'm not great at explaining them. But if you want to, just to answer your question a little bit, like async is a monad in this. So when I said that like a web part is, and I'll go back to the slide. When I said a web part was HTTP context async, HTTP context option. Async is almost a type of monad, and in F# they're called computation expressions, and you can you have like bind and the other stuff that goes with all that. That's the closest monad that I worked with in the language, but there's a bunch of other ones, obviously. That's not some area I'm super comfortable talking about, so I don't want to confuse anybody else trying to explain it. But thank you. So let's see, what else do I have? Where he said, we don't really have a lot of questions. So in summary, we can compose a web application just using higher order functions, and you can create your own higher order functions. And then as you guys saw, I could almost keep completely separate my domain specific functions and then use them just in one place. And if you really think about it big picture, I can compose other functions that do all of the other things I said that you should probably do, like have a type for the input to our web API. Like a response should have more information. Like if there's a validation error, I need to know about that, and that's gonna be a different type, so I need to have all that in there. And so you could be working with three different types, but as far as this is concerned, like the example I showed you, I just care about one little function, and I just compose all these little functions together. I love the way that looks, and the fact that my business and domain stuff was completely separated. And you could imagine, just like anything else, if I had other processes in there, like I need to go fire off an event on another microservice, that could again be abstracted somewhere else. There's a lot of really great resources for F# and functional programming in general. I would recommend highly, and I don't know why I put it last, it should be first, F# for Fun and Profit. And even if you're not on the .NET stack, it is a great way to talk about functional programming to somebody like me who doesn't have a strong math background. I'm computer science, I hated calculus, I just wanted to write code. But then I fell in love with functional programming later and was sad that I didn't pay attention in those classes like I should have. So it's great at explaining those things, and it talks about them in ways that people who are more imperative and OO can understand. And then it starts to dig into some of the things like monads through other examples. The other book I would recommend is called The Book of F#, and it's the book I usually take with me when I travel. But I've gotten more comfortable with the language now that I don't need to take it as much. But that's the first book I would read on it. And then now I'm reading a book called F-Sharp Applied, which is where I got some of the information for this talk. And it does some really cool stuff with the web and functional programming. It talks about functional reactive programming. So like you create a React web interface that calls your web API, and then create a web socket that uses microservices to do some cool stuff. I mean, it's a great book. I think it was on, it's like $20. And highly recommend that one also. He's got a good blog too. In fact, like the part, the file I didn't show you, the JSON file, that's all from his book because I didn't want to figure out how to write it myself, but it's on the web. So I don't have anything else. Thank you all for sitting here.